recording and it will be saved in your laptop. Okay.
Yeah, you should have recording.
Yeah. I can see now. Okay. Let me share my screen. Okay. You can see my screen, right?
Yeah, I can see the screen very well now.
Okay. That's good. That's good. Okay. Let me quickly start the session. So as of now, you two people are there, but in the next coming days, people are going to join in this batch. Okay. So let me quickly start. What is the SQL Server? Where we are going to use this SQL Server? Okay. How many versions are there in the SQL Server? Like we are going to discuss about the SQL Server. What will be the DBA activities in the organization? What a SQL DBA will do? What is his regular activities? What is his regular duties? Okay, these things and all we are going to discuss in today's demo session. This is just a demo session. We are not going to discuss any of the technical things today's session. Just we will discuss what will be the course, how will be the course, how many days it will take, how to manage the course, how to practice. Okay, everything we are going to discuss in this session. Okay, if you have any network issues or else if you are unable to hear me, please stop me immediately and just let me know, okay, so that I can improve my network issues and all. Okay, right. Thank you for that. Okay, thanks for joining, first of all. Right, so let me quickly jump into the session. Okay, you people are there to learn SQL Server, right? What is a SQL Server? Where we are going to use this SQL Server? Okay, any idea? Peter, do you have any idea what is a SQL Server? Where we are going to use this software?
SQL Server is a collection of databases.
Okay, very good. Okay.
Where information is stored in different formats like structured and unstructured.
Very good, excellent, excellent, yeah. Okay, fine. Yeah, any other things you know about SQL Server?
Also, not only for storage, but it's also used to retrieve to retrieve information.
Okay, okay, very good, excellent, excellent. Okay, yeah, that basic knowledge is enough. Okay, so I'll tell you what is a SQL Server. SQL Server is a software. Okay, SQL Server is a software. Some people will call it as a database software. Yes, of course, it's a database software only. SQL Server is a database software. Okay. By using the SQL Server, we can store the data and process the data and retrieve the data. These are the main, okay, things of the SQL Server, main features of the SQL Server. SQL Server is a RDBMS software. We are going to call it as a RDBMS software. What is meant by this RDBMS? Okay, RDBMS means Relational Database Management System. SQL Server is an RDBMS software which is going to use to store the data, to process the data, and to retrieve the data. For all these three things, we are going to use SQL Server. Okay, SQL Server is an RDBMS software, means Relational Database Management Software, which is going to use to store the data, to process the data, and to retrieve the data. So we can use SQL Server. By using SQL Server, we can store the data. Okay, and we can process the data. That process the data which we are storing. By using the data, we can process the data, and we can also retrieve. Why we are storing the data? To retrieve the data, right? Whenever we want to retrieve the data. Okay, so I have 2 terabytes of data, but I am not going to retrieve the data, or else it is not possible to retrieve the data. Then what is the use of this 2 terabytes of data? Waste, right? Waste of storage, waste of resources. Everything is waste. So saving is an important thing. In the same way, you want to retrieve the saving data is also an important thing. Okay, so how we are saving the data, in the same way we have to retrieve the data also. So by using SQL Server, we can store the data, we can process the data, and we can retrieve the data. So where we are going to use this software? Okay, where we are going to use this software? Say for example, just go to any of the application. We are going to call an application. Okay, Amazon.com, Amazon.in. Okay, anything. Everything is an application only. Let me go to the Amazon.com. Okay, if I go to this Amazon.com, okay, so this is my application. So how exactly an application will work? Okay, every application will work in a three-tier architecture. What is this three-tier architecture? I'll tell you. Okay, if you go here, if you can see, okay, you can see one image right on my desktop. You can see one image right. So this is how a three-tier architecture will look like. For every application, this three-tier architecture is common. For every application, whether it is internal application, external application, any application. So you people may have a doubt. There are different types of applications. One is external application and the second one is internal application. What is this external application and all the websites which we are going to connect daily are the external applications like Amazon, Facebook. Okay, these things and all external applications people are going to use throughout the globe. Okay, these are the external application. Then what is meant by internal application? Okay, internal application means what? Say for example, you went to one bank. Okay, any bank, you just went to Bank of America. Okay, so there, once you go to the Bank of America, they are going to use the systems, right? So once they started using the system, they will design one customized applications for their internal banking purpose. Okay, so once you go to the bank, they will ask your customer ID or else like your account number. They will type your account number. They are going to get all the details about you. Okay, so where they are typing, where they are accessing, they will have some internal applications. Those applications cannot be accessed by the public. But again, internet banking is another applications from the bank. Internet banking,
yeah,
who is the customer of the bank, they can easily access that internet banking.
Yeah.
Yeah. Peter, any issues?
You know.
Yeah, they can't be fair.
How?
I do a class, man.
Oh, you do a class?
Yeah.
Okay. I did download.
Yeah, Peter.
I'm getting you, sir.
Yeah. You are there, right? I can proceed, right, Peter?
Yeah, continue.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. That's fine. Okay. So we are discussing about internal applications and external applications, right? So if you go to any bank, there you can see some of the applications as an internal applications. They will have some loan kind of thing. They want to process some of the loans. For that, they will have their own system, their own applications. The applications which are using for internal purpose are called internal applications. The applications which are used for public domain is called external applications. Internal application or external application, they all will follow the same concept of three-tier architecture. So this is called your three-tier architecture. So you just to go to your browser, maybe Google Chrome or some other browser, you just open this browser and you just type www.amazon.com. Okay, you just type www.amazon.com in the browser. Whenever you type that application name, okay, usually it is in a website name. Whenever you type that name, immediately a request will go to the web servers. Okay, the first immediately once you enter that particular name, and you just hit the enter button, then if you have good internet connection, okay, immediately the request will go to the web server of the Amazon. Okay, for every application, there is a set of servers. Okay, Amazon will have web servers, application servers, database servers. Like that, every application, this is the common structure. Every Facebook will have its own web server, its own application server, its own database server. So like that, once you just type www.amazon.com, first the request will go to the Amazon server, Amazon web server. Okay, from web server, then the request will go to the application server, so that you can see the application like this. This is my Amazon.com application. Okay, so whenever you type an application www.amazon.com, first the request will go to the web server of the Amazon. From web server, again, it will go to the application server of that particular Amazon application. Okay, this is your application. You can see like this, right? So this is only coming because of application servers. Application servers, what is meant by application? If I want to say clearly, what is meant by application, first of all? Application is an interface between the user, means you. Application is an interface between the user and the database. Okay. Finally, at the end of the day, any application, they have to save the data in the database only. At the end of the day, they have to save the data in the database only. If you want to retrieve the data from the database, okay, is it possible for a normal people? Now, everyone who are having a mobile phones, everyone who are having smartphones, they are simply installing Amazon app and they are purchasing daily, they are purchasing some of the things. Okay, see, if I want to say, for example, if there is no application, only database is there, can they search in the Amazon application by writing the queries and all? Okay, no one can search, right? Simply they are having application interface, they are clicking whatever object they want, they are clicking on the object, or else whatever they want to buy, they are simply typing that object name in that particular search button of the Amazon. Okay, so application is an interface between the user and the database. Why? Because user cannot directly access the database. If you want to access the database, you should know some query. You should know some queries. Okay, you have to run some queries. Then only you can retrieve the data. But normal people, they will not write queries, right? They will simply log into the application. They will simply click on any object, or else they will simply type the object name and they will simply click on that object. They will go to the payment page. Okay, how this is happening? With the help of application interface. Okay, so whenever you just type the amazon.com, first the request will go to the web server. Okay, here the web server will change the name into the domain address, domain into the name. Okay, like that, IP address, name into IP address, and amazon.com is a domain name. Okay, it will have one IP address and all. Okay, its own IP address will be there, so immediately it will reach that IP address once you just type www.amazon.com. Right, from there it will go to the application server. You know, right, application server means this is the application. Okay, this interface is coming with the help of application servers only. Okay, so immediately the request will touch the application server. Okay, once you go to here, what you will try, amazon.com is a shopping site, right? What you will try to buy one item. Okay, say for example, you just clicked on this item, you want to buy this item. Okay, you can see this is the gaming headset. Okay, you can see here. Okay, right, this is the gaming headset. You want to buy this item. So whenever you want to buy this item, what you did now, just you just clicked on this product, right? Simply you just clicked on this product. So actually, once you just clicked on this product, you can see the product specifications, the product description. Okay, and the product, like what are the features, what are the advantages, everything you can see in the description of the product, and reviews, okay, replies, everything about the product information you can see in this page. Where you are getting, from where you are getting this information? From where we are getting this information about the product? Yeah, so we are getting this information from the database server, right? But if you want to, okay, get the information, if you want to retrieve the data from the database server, what you have to do? You have to write the query. But did you write the query now? Simply, you are just clicking this object. You are just clicking on this product. Remember one thing, whenever you are clicking on any item, okay, in the application, whenever you're clicking on any item or option, it will only write the query. Okay, that query will be executed on the database server. Okay, so once the request go to the web server, the request will go to the application server now. Okay, if application will open, once the application is opened, you will try, you will just click on any product. Then once you just click it, for every click there is a query. Okay, if I click here, one query will run. If I click here, another query will run. Say here, for every product there will be a different query, right? If I click here, one query will execute on the database server. If I click here, a separate query will execute on the database server. If I click here, one more query will execute on the database server. Depends upon the query we are writing, we are getting the results from the database server. That means we are retrieving the data. So for every click, there is a query will run in the background. Where this query will run? Okay, this query will run on the database server. This is your database server. You can see here, right? This is your database server. Okay, so once you just clicked on the product, there will be a query executed on the particular database server. Once the query is executed, it has to throw some output, right? It has to give some output. Okay, that output means this product information. You just clicked on this product, then immediately in the background one query run on the database server. Once it ran successfully, you will get the output. So this is the output of that query. Okay. So again, what happened? The query will come, right? That query will come in the database server. The database server will send that query, that output, to the application server again. Again, from this application server to that response sent to the web server again. Again, from this web server to it will send to the browser again. Okay. So imagine if you want to click, or else if you want to see the information of the any product, how many clicks you are going, how many responses it is going. Okay, this is one response, this is second response, web server to browser to web server one response, web server to application server second response, application server to database server third response, and executing the query on the database server fourth response, and again it is returning the results to the application server fifth response, from application server to web server sixth response, from web server to your browser seventh response. So whenever you are clicking any object, whenever you are clicking on any object in the application, it will undergo seven phases or else seven responses, but we don't see anything. Simply we are logging to the application, we are simply clicking on this. Okay, so what happened? Whenever you are clicking on the application, immediately seven responses. After seven responses only you can see the item information. This is called three-tier architecture. This is common for any application. Application is there means this three-tier architecture will be there. Okay, so without this three-tier architecture you cannot access the application like this. Is it clear, Peter, Srinivas, any issues?
Okay, sir.
Yeah, Peter, is it clear?
Yes,
yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so here we have a database server, right? Okay, we have a database server here. This database server may be anything. Okay, we have lots of database server softwares. Okay, we have SQL Server is one software in the database side, Oracle, MySQL, NoSQL, DB2, MongoDB, Informatica. Okay, lot of database softwares are there. In that software, if people are using SQL Server, then SQL DBA work will start. Okay, in that software there are a lot of vendors are there. We are going to call it as a vendor. Okay, Microsoft is one vendor, Oracle is one vendor. Okay, MySQL, NoSQL, Sybase, these are the vendors. Like I want to buy one smartphone. Okay, there are a lot of smartphones in the market. Apple iPhone is there, Samsung is there, MI is there. Okay, different phones are there. Depends upon the features, depends upon the particular budget you are going to fix one phone. In the same way, while choosing the database software, they will check the features, they will check the budget, okay, everything they will check, and finally they will decide one software. They are going to use that software as a backend database software. This software will be in the backend. The database software will always be in the backend. That's why people are going to call database softwares are backend softwares. Backend database means you cannot directly access the database. Okay, you means the public cannot directly access the database directly. Okay, so that's why we are going to call this as a backend software. Whenever they click any application name, automatically you can see, right, immediately the application will come, right? So that's why application we are going to call it as a front end applications. We are going to call any application as a front end applications, any database softwares as a back end database softwares or back end softwares. That's why like this only the name came. Why? Because database will always be in the back end, software will all, application will always be in the front end. So front end applications, back end databases. Okay, that's why we are going to call front end and back end. Clear, right? So if people are using SQL Server, then SQL DBA work will start. Here in the database server, if people are using SQL Server, SQL DBA work will start. If people are using Oracle, Oracle DBA work will start. MySQL, MySQL DBA work will start. DBA is nothing but a database administrator. DBA means database administrator. Okay, don't think DBA is SQL DBA. DBA means simply a database administrator. He may be a SQL DBA, he may be a Oracle DBA, he may be a Mongo DBA, he may be a MySQL DBA. Like that, there are a lot of flavors are there in the DBA. Okay, so If they are using SQL Server, then SQL DBA work will start. Clear, right? Okay, so this is what exactly the SQL Server. So just this is just an introduction of the SQL Server. Later, after like this completion of this course, okay, during this course, okay, throughout this course, you will came to know what is exactly a SQL Server. This is just a basic definition of the SQL Server. Okay, SQL Server is an RDBMS software which is going to store the data, process the data, and retrieve the data. Okay, right, fine. So we are discussing about data. What is this data, first of all? Right, what is this data? Usually we'll have a confusion, right? What is this data and all? Okay, so there is a difference between data and information. Okay, there is a difference between data and information. Okay, database servers will always process the data from the information. They are going to process the SQL Server or Oracle, any database software. It will process the data and it will process the data into the information. Data means unstructured raw data. Data means unstructured thing. Data is nothing but an unstructured thing. Information is nothing but a structured data. Information means a structured data. Once you process this unstructured data, it will convert into information. Okay, once you process this unstructured data, it will convert into information. So there is a difference between data and information. Okay, data is nothing but an unstructured thing. By using this database softwares, you are going to process this data into the information. Say for example, here this is a raw data. Just for example, on the screen, you can see some kind of raw data. What is this raw data showing? 10,000. We don't know what is this 10,000. Is it employee ID or else any other thing? And Mahesh. Mahesh is the name. Okay. And IT. Don't know what is this IT. KR from ABC Apartments. Okay. By just looking these values, we can't came to the final judgment. What is this data about? Okay. I just want to process this data. How I'm going to process this data? I'm going to process this data by just adding some attributes or by just adding some values to this data. See here. Now I just added some attributes like employee ID, employee name, department, address, salary. So in this case, you can't get a clear picture what is this data about. But once I started this data into the information, at least you have an idea. Okay, this belongs to an employee record. Or else this belongs to employee details. Okay, I just added employee ID as a one attribute. I just added employee name as one attribute. Then department as one attribute. Then address, then salary. This 10,000 belongs to salary. Okay, so I just process this data by adding some attributes to this data. So this data converted into the information, a meaningful information. Data is unstructured thing, whereas information is a meaningful, okay, meaningful information. Okay, so like this data, we are going to process the data. Okay, we means the SQL Server will add some attribute. The SQL Server will process the data. Okay, so apart from this, apart from processing, SQL Server will also do a lot of things. What it will do? Okay, so it will do analysis. SQL Server will do analysis using SQL Server Analysis Services, SSAS. Okay, SQL Server Analysis Services. And it will generate reports by using the data in the database. That is called Reporting Services, SSRS. By using SQL Server, you can generate the reports also. Okay, for that you have to install one more extra component called SSRS. And SSIS is nothing but integration services. You want to integrate the data from different sources to SQL Server or from SQL Server to different sources like Oracle and all. Okay, say for example, you want to import some data from Oracle to SQL Server. You want to export some data from SQL Server to an Excel sheet. Okay, so this all come under integration services. You are going to integrate the data between the different data sources. Okay, so by using SQL Server, we can analyze the data, we can generate reports, and we can integrate the data from different sources. Okay, this can be achieved with the help of SSIS, RS, and AS. Okay. So apart from data storing, processing, and retrieving, SQL Server, we can also use the SQL Server for storing, for analyzing the data, for report, for generating reports, and for integrate the data from different sources to different sources. Okay. Yeah. So where the software will be used, I just discussed, right? This software will be used as a backend for any application, whether it is a banking application, whether it is a shopping site, whether it is an internal application. For any application, this software will be used as a backend software. Okay. What will be the duties and activities of the DBA? What a DBA will do exactly? Okay. Let me show you what a SQL DBA will do exactly. Okay. These are the activities. These are the main activities of the DBA. Okay, so as a DBA, it is our responsibility to install the SQL Server, to manage the SQL Server, and to maintain the SQL Server. Okay, as a DBA, it's our responsibility to install the SQL Server, to manage the SQL Server, and to maintain the SQL Server. Okay, we are going to discuss how to install, how to manage, and how to maintain the SQL Server. Okay, of course, creating logins. Why? Because it is very important. Data is very important, guys. Very important. Okay, future is all about data only. Data is very important. That may be any data. Okay, that may be your personal data also. Okay, any data is very important. So that's why we cannot give permissions to everyone to access the data. Okay, there should be some security. Only these people, this set of people only has to access my data. These people only has to access my data. In that case, you have to give hierarchy, you have to give priority, you have to give permissions. Okay, so depends upon the request we are going to get from the customer, we are going to give permissions to access the data to the people. That is all come under creating logins. We have to create those who want to access my data. For them, we have to create some logins in the SQL Server, and we have to give some permissions. Then only those people can access the data. Okay, and of course, as a DBA, we are going to do these things also. Taking backups, and very important, just now we discussed, right, data is very important. Okay, so we are storing lots and lots of data, but suddenly the server crashed, or suddenly the hard disk was crashed, then what is the use? All the efforts were gone, all the money were gone. So for that purpose, don't know next minute what will happen. The server may crash, the drive may crash, or is like any natural calamity, any natural disasters may occur. Okay, so this kind of issues are there. So that's why what we'll do, we'll take the backup of the database. Okay, we'll take the backup of every data we are storing in the database. Okay, there will be some safety. If something happened to the database, we can simply use these backups to restore the database. Okay, so as a DBA, it is our responsibility for taking the backups and restoring the databases and all. Okay, right, what are the issues that are coming while taking the backups and restore the database? We have to fix those issues and all. And creating and scheduling the jobs and maintenance plans. Of course, there are very important jobs. What is this job and all? I'll tell you. Job is nothing but a automated thing. Job is nothing but not our regular job. In the SQL Server, there are some jobs. Okay, say for example, there are 100 databases in my SQL Server. Is it possible to take backup of 100 databases manually? Manually, you have to log into each server and you have to take the backup of each database. Is it possible? It is possible, but a time-taking process. Imagine if you have 100 databases only, you have to struggle a lot. Imagine if you have 1,000 databases. Is it possible to take manual backup of 1,000 databases? So for that, it should be an automated thing. It should automate. Automatically, the databases, the SQL Server has to take the backups. Okay. So for that purpose, what we'll do, we'll create some jobs. Once you just create some jobs and once you just automate these jobs, automatically, whenever you gave the schedule, say for example, today night, 12 o'clock, backup job should run. Then immediately at 12 o'clock, backup job will run and it will take the backup of all the databases in the server. So that is called automation. Automation can be achieved with the help of jobs and maintenance plans also. Okay, so it is our responsibility to create the jobs and to create the maintenance plans and all. And of course, throughout this course, we are going to learn how to create the jobs and maintenance plans. Okay, next, configuring high availabilities. Okay, what is this high availability? What is this high availability? Okay, is it so important to configure high availability? High availability means making the data highly available. Okay, High availability means making the data highly available. How you are going to achieve this target? How you are going to making the data highly available? Okay, say for example, one server is there. I have one Windows server is there. In that Windows server, I have installed SQL server. Okay, something happened to my server. Something happened, it was crashed. And engineers are working on it to just bring back the system. So it may take 1 hour or 2 hours. In that case, this 2 hours, your database software is down. Okay, imagine this 2 hours, Amazon database is down. How much loss it will be for the Amazon customer? How much loss if 1 hour, if 1 minute, not 2 hours, if 1 minute my Amazon database is down? Okay, imagine how much loss that that product owner, who is that owner? Who is the Amazon owner? Jeff Bezos. Okay, imagine how much loss he will get in this 1 minute. Like that, if my database is down for 1 hour, how much loss he will get? Okay, so don't think every time as Amazon. So even internal applications also, if 1 hour or 2 hours your database is down, is there will be some loss. Okay, if your net banking is not working for 1 hour, how much loss it will be? So that's why application and database will never be down. It should be our responsibility to make up and running for 24/7/365 days. Okay, so to achieve this, what we will do, we will configure high availabilities on the servers. High availability is nothing but simply, if for every server, there will be two servers. For every applications, there will be two servers. One will be active server, one will be inactive server. If any problem came for the active server, we are going to do failover to the inactive server. Okay, we are going to call it as a primary servers and secondary servers. Usually application will be connected to the primary server. Okay, if something happened to my primary server, or else nothing happened, simply you want to patch the server. Patching is regular activity, right? So while doing patching, the server will be down. At least half an hour or 1 hour. Okay, in that case, if my database is not available for 1 hour for the customers, you will get a lot of loss, right? So that's why, so what we'll do, we'll configure high availability on this application. Okay, immediately my primary server will be there, my secondary server will be there. If something happened to my primary server, I can redirect the application to the secondary server immediately. That is called high availability. We have a lot of high availabilities in the SQL server. Okay, lot of means five high availabilities are there. Okay, what are those high availability options? Log shipping is one high availability. Okay, mirroring is one high availability. Replication is one high availability. And clustering is one high availability. Okay, these are all the high availabilities. Okay. These are all high availabilities in the SQL server. Okay, so by using this high availability options, we are going to achieve the high availability in the SQL server. Okay, the meeting is going to close in 1 minute. Okay, again I'll open the same link. Just click on that link to join in the meeting. Okay, Peter. Yeah, Peter.
Yes, sir.
The meeting will close in 1 minute, okay? Again, I'll open the same meeting link. You just try to join again, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine, okay? So by using this log shipping, by using this mirroring, by using this replication, by using this clustering, by using this always on, we are going to configure high availability, okay? So we'll discuss how to configure all these things and all. We are going to discuss in our course, okay? This is all about your high availabilities. Next is like, fixing and troubleshooting the issues. Okay, of course, for any software, okay, some issues will come, right? This much process is there in the SQL server. So at any process, maybe during the login process, maybe during that jobs process, or else maybe while configuring, or else after configuration of the high availabilities, regularly errors will come, right? Errors or issues will come. It's our responsibility to fix all those issues and all. Okay. Right, and of course tuning the SQL server. Okay, we are going to discuss this tuning the SQL server also, how to tune the, but don't expect more in the performance tuning. Okay, performance tuning is again a separate session. Okay, 15 to 20